and we count down to episode 2. Hi everyone, welcome to another sporty Saturday evening. As we wait to welcome our viewers in, I'll let you guys all come in and say hellos to me. Rakshit, my buddy, thank you to coming in. Tanisha, freaking Roy boy, I like that handle. So, may we begin? Once again, hello and welcome to another sporty Saturday evening of the Sport On series. Wonderful streaming live videos for people of the sporting universe, the event experiential industry, where we bring in leading lights from the sports and experiential industry for their insights and their experiences. This is season 2 of the Sport On series. We had a very successful, wonderful edition, season 1 last year in 2020. And as we progress into the season 2 of Sport On series, which is brought to you by ISM, India's premier education institute for sports management. Hoping and saying that all of you are staying well and healthy, and hope you're having a very good weekend. That's great to know. So the last episode which we had on Saturday, the first episode, we had Mr. Salil Ankola, a former India cricketer and chairman selection committee for the Mumbai Ranji team, where he spoke about his career path from on field as an athlete and a cricketer, and then his rough patch and the tough times that he went through, and then his willingness and his resilience to bounce back. And today where he's back in the thick of action off the field, more so now, where he's giving back to sports and giving back to fitness and the goodness of the sporting industry. High intellectual savage, Alpha Bhushan, thank you guys for logging in. It's really a pleasure to connect with you via this sessions, you know, every Saturday, where essentially the objective is to be able to kind of let students, the student fraternity, the learning fraternity, and of course, professionals from the sports and experiential industry to be able to kind of get a bit insights into what stalwarts, successful professionals, entrepreneurs, athletes who've been there, and from their learnings, what we can take and go forward with. So let's get on with episode 2 of the Sport On series, season 2. And for today, who we have is a very, very dear friend of mine. I've known her from the time she got into the event management and being a professional experiential marketer, to then turning entrepreneur. And then she had a vision, and she held on to that vision and actually got a movement going. A movement which is not just big in India now, but is moving globally, where she set up Pinkathon. And it gives me great pleasure to welcome Ms. Reema Sanghvi, who's a co-founder of Pinkathon and the managing director of Maximize Media Solutions here today. Reema, if you're here, I'll try and get you in. Reema also dons various other hats, where started with Speaking Minds. She's been the vice president of EMA West, and she's done some exciting stuff there. Reema, welcome to Sport On. Can you hear me?
I can't see you, but where are you? Oh, what is happening?
Here I am.
Can you hear me? Can you see me? I can't see you at all.
I can see the pretty lady and I can hear you clearly, Reema.
Okay. What is happening?
You got some filters going there. Okay. Let me get Reema back again. So I was saying, Reema also served the experiential and Event Management Association as Vice President West, where she did very, very interesting activities. Yes, Reema, welcome back again.
Hi. Can you see me now without a filter?
did I have to show you the t-shirt I'm wearing and then you were coming on?
Oh my God, look at that. Look at that. This I gave you 2 years back.
And I was waiting for the right day to don this, right? It takes a certain moment.
Full
power,
God.
Full power to Pinkathon.
Full power to Pinkathon. Let's paint the world pink together.
Thank you so much, Reema, first and foremost, yeah, from all of us at Sporton Series, from ISM, from Nilesh and Rasika and the team here for kind of joining us today.
Pleasure is all mine.
In fact, let's start with just this, Pink Lady, as we all know you as well. Right?
Very for somebody, happy to be known that way.
For somebody who didn't like pink, right, and this is what we always talk about, for somebody who didn't like the color pink or didn't like pink, let's jump straight to...
I completely hated it. My friends, till date, I get trolled for it because every time I talk about pink, they said, we are not going to see you if you are wearing pink now. Okay, because every time I met my friends, I would tell them, if you're wearing pink, I won't even walk with you. I won't even talk to you. I'd probably say a few things that would really hurt them. But that's how much I hated pink. It's because, you know, I was a third girl child of the house and my dad always wanted me to be a boy. So everything related to a woman was pink at that point of time. And I would say, no, because I'm supposed to be my father's boy, I am not supposed to like pink. And that went on till college, till the time I made my friends, all of it. And I would like diss them all the time for the color pink. And look at the irony. I'm known as the pink lady of India now. It's crazy.
You're driving a global phenomenon with that color, which is empowering so many women.
I'm in love with the color now. I'm in love.
No, but amazing, you know, where it is reached today. And if you can actually take us through, before we get back to, you know, the life story, and a lot of us want to know more about it. I know a bit about it, Reema, but I'm sure a lot of viewers,
but
a lot of students with
you.
You know, I'm at the campus. I'm at the campus. Guess what?
I love the background. Is that what the IISM campus looks like? That is so cool.
So this is one of the locations. You know what we're doing? We decided every episode we will go to one location and hopefully, you know, kind of throw the light out, because the campus obviously is not being operational for students. So maybe the students can watch this. You know, everybody's having memories of their campus truly. We're kind of maintaining all the necessary regulations.
Right.
We come in with our mask and all that. So very few here. But yeah, today we are live from the pavilion, as they call it, IISM, the cafeteria. It's such a fun place.
Wow.
Such a fun location, yeah. So that's the idea. Every episode, we're trying to come from something.
There's a lot of noise, background noise. Is there some background noise?
Is this clear? No, I think I can.
You're echoing.
Okay.
Perfect.
From the pavilion, I guess this is how it sounds.
You're completely, but it's okay now. It's fine. Yeah.
Okay. So I was asking, is that... Yeah, I mean, from where did you, like, you've been an experiential marketer, right? You started with event management, but then you got on to this dream or the vision, if I may. So tell us about how Pinkathon came to be for all of us.
So, you know, what happened is, so should I talk about my entrepreneurial journey as to how Maximus started and then Pinkathon, right? So I'm just going to take you through that. So,
however you are comfortable.
Yeah, so I ventured into events in about 2007. I worked for a company and then started Maximus by 2008. But what happened is that we were an experiential mice company. And, you know, we did luxury mice. And but I was an athlete in school and I did running all my life. So, you know, in my while my education was on at the grassroots level, sports was completely inculcated into our curriculum. And that's what made it, you know, that's, I think I attribute a lot of the making of Pinkathon to that. I think 2012, which was 4 years into the business, is when my partner, who is Milind Soman, as you know, you know, so we were toying with the idea of doing a woman's run for a very long time. And, you know, because it was only 4 years into the business, I was very skeptical about taking a jump into the IP space when we were doing luxury mice. So I now had to do a mass event, unlearn everything that I was probably doing and good at. And now I had to do a running event. But given the fact, once again, I say that, you know, because sports was at the grassroots level, because we were all the time during our education, sports was inculcated into us, is today why I feel that the idea of a running event for women even appealed to me in the first place. So this is what I say, you know, that when an opportunity strikes your door, you must give it a bear hug. And, you know, you must learn how to recognize that opportunity. And that's exactly what happened to me. And I was probably lucky or wise enough at that point of time that when Milind and me were discussing, and then Milind suddenly one fine day announced it in the newspaper, he being Milind, he comes to my doorstep and says, this is what I've announced, a woman's run. And Shaju, it was somewhere in July. And I looked at him and I said, thank you very much, because until now we were just toying with the idea. And now I completely had to do it. I had to unlearn and learn how to do a sporting mass event. Right. And this is what we did. So, you know, I don't know how to even describe the struggle that happened from July to December, because I had literally 6 months to do this event, because he had announced it for December. And this is what happened. And, you know, like we are, right? We are event managers. We are sports managers. We will do anything in this world to make our event happen, no matter what comes through. You know,
and keep in mind, this is the big, crazy world of IPs, right? It requires something else to kind of dwell in this ecosystem.
Absolutely, Shaju. And was 4 years into the business and I had to build a sporting IP. And in a country where women were not running. Okay, so women weren't running in this country. And, you know, so we had to not only build an IP, but I think we had to build a culture. You know, we had to build the culture of running in this country. And that's what, you know, but we were so, the belief comes from the fact that sports was inculcated into us. And that's why, you know, Milind's a runner, I'm a runner, all, you know, put together, we made a great tag team. And this is where, you know, the belief, the idea changed into reality. And we, of course, then started with a plan. You know, I can't tell you, Shaju, the first year round. Oh, by the way, the name Pinkathon is a great story, because I hated the color pink until then. And
which is why I wanted to know, how did the name come to be?
So, by the way, when that newspaper in July came to me, June or July, I can't remember correctly, but June or July, when that newspaper and Milind and everybody was sitting in the room, kid you not, Shaju. I was literally, you know, it took me 10 minutes to name the run, because I told Milind, very good, you've announced the run, but the run doesn't even have a name. We have no identity. We have nothing. But because of, you know, I have to say my the stereotypes in my head that pink is only to do with women. At that point of time, it came out with Pinkathon. Women's run has to be Pinkathon. You know, and not with all the love in the world, by the way. It came out with, oh my God, it's a woman's run, right? Let's do Pinkathon, because Pinkathon. And Milind at one shot said, that's it. That's the name of the run. And
it was your destiny. Rima, it was your destiny to bring pink back into your life.
I'm telling you. But I have to tell you that when the first run happened in December 2012, Taju, until now, it was only, like I said, you know, I was trying to save my business. You know, I was 4 years into the business. I wanted my employees to be extremely happy. I didn't want to invest complete monies into an IP. And suddenly I had to, so I was very aware. So Pinkathon at that point of time was only about me making an IP, a very successful IP. And, but I have to tell you, the struggle that I went through from July to December, it opened my eyes to a world which was which I couldn't believe existed. You know, we constantly say that women is an oppressed part of the society. It is truly so. It is, because when I saw the 2,500 women, which I collected by, you know, literally going door to door and saying, you know, participate in a run, please participate in a run, because the country wasn't running. And when I saw those 2,500 women running on a Sunday morning, early morning, giving up everything in their households, coming and running for the freedom of it all, for, you know, and let me tell you, all shapes, sizes, colors, everything turned up at the Pinkathon. Women came up to us and said, we want to say a few things on the stage about our experience. And you know, they all started with, so Pinkathon started with the cause of breast cancer. And, you know, women who had suffered and were surviving from breast cancer went up there on stage, narrated their stories. We spoke about bras, we spoke about breasts, we spoke about everything that was taboo in the world of women. And it was, and I realized that day, and that day changed my life, right? 16th of December 2012 changed my life, because I knew that day that, oh my God, there is such a dearth of this in our systems. And from that day, I took an oath that I'm never going to stop. Never, no matter what kind of investment it takes, no matter what it takes, this movement, it was no more an IP, this movement has to go on. I talk about it and again, goosebumps, but running then became, and running with Pinkathon then became like a life agenda. And, you know, and that's how it all started. That's how Pinkathon started. And that's how my love for pink came by. And now the vision is only to paint the world pink.
More power to you, lady, and more power to Million and the entire team there. Really, it's no longer work. It's no longer business, right? It's an emotion you're living with.
Absolutely.
You've empowered so many ladies, so many girls. In fact, not just women and girls, even families, right? As a husband, I would love my daughter to kind of explore and go beyond, my wife to be out there. So it's not just about for the women of the world or the country. It's also for their partners or their families to be able to give that opportunity. And you created that opportunity.
Absolutely. You know, today, Shaju, I would say, you know, 1 out of 10 households in India will boast of the fact that the woman in their house has started their journey towards fitness with the Pinkathon. You know, and let me tell you, across India and across the world, at least right while we are talking as well, there's some event of Pinkathon going on. You know, because it's now no more managed by us, right? It's managed by the ambassadors of Pinkathon. And who work for the love of Pinkathon night and day. They create events,
yoga,
they do everything under the world of fitness now for Pinkathon.
Guess what happened today morning? My daughter taught me a few yoga steps this morning. Said, Papa, come on, get onto that mat.
So,
more power to all of you, really. And it gives me great pleasure and an honor to wear this tee, you know, for you guys, because it's a moment which is going to go good.
My love.
Can you hear me now?
The headset, completely.
One second, hold on. Yeah, is this clearer now? Yeah. So I'm saying great. Okay. So Reema, you mentioned about Pinkathon and the whole origin and all that. And you know, it was a, let me say something which, as Indians, we never used to run per se, right? We played sports. We watched sports as participate, as an audience.
Yeah.
But when the marathon started, and I get this from another dear friend of ours, right? Anil Singh and Vivek, when they said,
of course.
When they started this whole movement of marathon, the first Mumbai marathon, you know, and the entire authorities were saying, are you crazy how people are going to run on the streets of Mumbai or streets wherever, and they're going to even pay for it? But what a movement that has started and to where we are today. How many marathons happen in the country? Any approximate idea?
3,000 to 4,000 marathons across the country.
But in a year?
In a year, yeah. 3,000 to 4,000 marathons in the country. And but I mean, the most iconic of all is the Mumbai marathon, for sure, because of what they've built. And they actually built the running culture in the country. While we built it with women, they built the entire culture for the entire population as a pro camp. So yes, for sure, man, they are legends.
And today, look at a country, and we say India is a young country, right, for the world. And this is such an essential part of all of us, right, as we are, whether you're a 10-year-old or you're at 100. You have runners who are at, what, 100, 110 yet? I saw some news clippage of a lady who's 100-plus and was running the Pinkathon.
So our mascot, our run's mascot is Mankor, and she actually represents the country for wetland sports. And she is 105 years old now.
Oh my God.
And she runs. Yes, so she's our mascot. And but you know, this is what I say, right? Like what Anil did is, you know, looked at an opportunity and said there's a gap in this country for that sport. And he actually chased his dream to make it happen. So I keep saying this, that if you believe in your idea and, you know, and create a plan towards making it happen, it will happen. All you have to do is recognize that opportunity and give it one big, warm bear hug. So very important.
So this is true.
And of course, we have mascots. We have, while Mankor is a mascot, Shaju, you have to know we do something called the Spirit of Pinkathon. And Spirit of Pinkathon is when every time we go to a city with a run, which is, let's say, if you're going to Pune, there's a group of women who run from Mumbai to Pune, right? And in 2 days, they run from Mumbai to Pune, which wow. means they do about 60 kilometers a day, 60 to 70 kilometers a day. So we started with two women. It went to four women. In 2019, we did 40 women who ran from Mumbai to
Bombay
Pune.
To Pune. Wow, amazing.
The beauty of it all is that the oldest woman was 70 years old. Who did the run from Mumbai to Pune. Now this is iconic. Like, I mean, you can't see this. And she trained for it. She went for trainings every day. We did the trainings for Mumbai to Pune. And she ran. She actually finished Mumbai to Pune. It was crazy. So this is the junoon behind Pinkathon. You know? And this is what Pinkathon has created. It's unbelievable.
Amazing. How was your junoon as a child? Now I'm taking you back in time.
Yeah.
Were you into sports when you were in your school or college? Where did this originate? I'm sure it must have been something out there.
Completely, Shaju. Completely. I also think it's so important, and I said in the beginning, so important, and this is something that India doesn't have, is sports inculcated at grassroots level in our curriculums. Very, very important. And that I studied in Oman, born and brought up in Oman, and my school had sports. Like, you know, we used to finish school, come back home, change, and run back to school only to do sports. And we would come back at 7 in the evening only after, you know, finishing our sports. And by the way, I was the fastest long distance runner in Oman. The longest distance though I did was 25 kilometers, and I'm not a marathoner. But 25 kilometers, and I hold a record still. But yes, all throughout. So I've done long jump, basketball. You know, I've done so 400, 800 meters was my my go-to race. I would do only 400 meters and 800 meters. But then I participated in the 25 kilometers all across Oman, and I won it. It's been there all throughout. As a child, I was an absolute athlete, and I loved to be in sports. And that's exactly why I said the idea of doing a women's run in India was so appealing, because there were no women running, and there was time to make a change. And
there had to be a foundation, there had to be some exposure. See, it all comes back to you, whatever you saw. I think one of the students wrote, Junoon is also the festival which is run by the students of IISM. Wow, that's interesting.
Oh, lovely.
So there you go. And it's so
the
good to have the students be
called Pinka Junoon.
Why not? Collaborate well. Sorry, you were saying something and I kind of was staying. Yeah.
So what was I saying? I'm sorry, I missed out as well. I was actually...
About school. I think about your exposure of the school curriculum in school and sports in school.
Exactly. No, but that, of course, and that's so very important, like I said, and we must, as so we are doing a lot of stuff. I'm now in the panel of the CII, Sports Committee, and this is what we're constantly preaching to the government as well, that at grassroots level, sports curriculum. And of course, you know, if you see, the education ministry is also making huge amount of changes in the way our curriculums are planned, and, you know, they're really forward thinking now. A lot of things are being changed in the way education is perceived in India. So all of this is going to change. And of course,
absolutely.
And stuff like that, we're going to preach more and more to the government.
Yeah, which is what Nilesh has told me, that apparently it's going to be a subject compulsory for school.
Yes.
Sports is going to be a compulsion. Yeah,
and I'm so glad it is. You know, I mean, it's high time.
So thanks to all your efforts here, all you guys out there spearheading this movement, you know, every child should have that as a subject, because ultimately, and I remember this, you would always look for that break to get out and play, right? Football, cricket, or just run out of class.
Absolutely.
Why can't that be?
Yeah, I think sports is nirvana. And why only 100 and 100 in math, if I may say, why 100 and 100 in English, and why not 100 and 100 in math in sports? So, you know, why treat it so differently? But let's build a culture that has sports inculcated. Look at internationally. I mean, they probably give more importance to sport than, academics. And that is what...
Slowly but surely.
I wouldn't say...
Slowly but surely.
Both are important, I would say. So, but give equal weightage, which is very important.
Right.
That is missing in our country.
And thanks to the education system being refurbished and, you know, refreshed up, I'm sure we'll see India truly coming out as a sporting nation is what we all are wishing for, right?
Yeah, we're you know, yeah. some milestones away, but yes, we are at least taking steps to rectify it. I think we've seen more participation even in you know, all the sporting leagues. Of course, you know, and now we are thinking beyond cricket, which is very, very important. I think our nation only thought about cricket. We are thinking beyond that. I think that's important, you know, to widen our horizon. We've seen so many women athletes now emerge, you know, after Mary Combs of the world. We've seen so many women, but we need more. There is, you know, we're one of the most populated countries in the world. We need more.
Of course, and hoping that many more medals come our way with the Olympics, which is forthcoming, right? I mean, the women are in the forefront there as well.
I'm so glad Olympics is happening. It's so good for the athletes today, you know, who worked their ass out, if I may say, through the year, through the months, through the years, all of it. I'm so glad Olympics is happening for them. And it's spectator-less, so it's going to be safe.
Safe, and yeah. And it's a global broadcast event, right? So we can all watch what is happening, and the power of broadcast, why not, yeah?
Why not? And, yeah. You know, more than broadcast, I think the whole idea of them getting to compete for what they've been,
training for years,
is finally coming true for them, which might have been a far-fetched dream right now.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. You got a cup of tea or coffee, Reema?
Oh,
because it's an easy weekend. Is that green tea?
Black coffee.
Okay.
So now, I have my caffeine before 6 p.m. Finish. After that, no caffeine in my body.
I'm sure Milind is Milind keeping a tab on what you're having, or that's your inbuilt system?
Milind will never preach coffee, by the way. Milind does not preach coffee at all. He has jaggery chai.
Oh wow, he's somebody who's
I have Muleti chai, but I need my cup of coffee for sure, so I'm not going to hide that. But dairy less, no dairy, no sugar.
There you go, yeah. Perfect.
I think nutrition is an important thing in a sportsman's life. I think when we do a sports curriculum, nutrition also becomes such a big aspect of that. I think that also should be somewhere inculcated in the curriculum. Is nutrition. Fads, the protein powders, all of that is all such a fad, and you shouldn't indulge in those, whether in whatever sort of protein it is. Take it by the actual source of protein rather having these powders. All of these things are so important for a sportsman's life. But I'm sure that's another huge topic.
Huge conversation. But we'll come to that. I want to, and for the sake of some of our viewers and also students, you know,
yeah.
I want to take us back to when you had your career start, Reema. You know, event management or experiential marketing, as we know, was still in some form of a growth stage, right? I mean, when I got in 25 years back, there was no event management as a term. We were called party planners, you know that. And then it happened to be. How did you pick this career up? I mean, give us a little insight to that part of your life phase when you said, this is my career path, event management, moving on to, let's say, experiential marketing.
So Shaju, you know, there is a rebel in me, so you should know that. But
I'm
all
sure.
That is
I know that.
But there is a constant rebel. So I never wanted to do, you know, I'm born and brought up in Oman, further studies in Calcutta. Once Calcutta was over, I stayed with my uncle and aunt in Calcutta. I wanted to run out of Calcutta because life was literally so slow for me. And I needed to run out for some reason. So I came to Mumbai for my Narsi Munji MBA. And MBA in Narsi Munji, I never got through. I'm going to really snap through this so that it's easier to understand. And I didn't get through my MBA. What do I do? My mother's telling me to come back to Oman. I said, I'm not coming back to Oman because, you know, Oman is a slow city in terms of, you know, for growth prospects. So
And a decade back for sure. Huh? Yeah. And a decade back for sure, now it's much more developed, but a few years back.
Then during that time, it wasn't. So I'm talking 2001 or something like that. And I refused to go back. So I took up a job, and that time, a really well-paying job was the call center job. I actually started working in a call center. And by the way, my entire family is from a business background. But they didn't understand at that point of time what a call center was. They said, okay, Reema's got a job. She wants to work in Mumbai. I just picked up the job just to stay, afloat, as I would say. And didn't want to go back to Oman. then slowly my mother's like, I think about 6 months passed away, and my mother's saying, this girl's not coming back, she's not telling us what she's doing. My mother shifted to Mumbai for me. Given that, you know, then she was like, I'm not going to let you work in the nights, all of that happened. So I picked up a job, and then, oh, by the way, while I was in the call center, you guys should know that I didn't stick to my job. So, you know, call centers, I don't know if most of you know, the call centers have about 3,000, 4,000 people in it. And, you know, there's a constant R&R that happens every week or every quarter. And I became the head of that committee who would organize all this, all the R&Rs for all the people at the call center. So I got like hands-on experience in doing events, and I realized this was my calling. I really enjoy organizing things. And I joined Platinum after that. So I quit the call center job and I joined Platinum Events. And I worked there for a year and a half, and I learned what MICE was. Really, Sushil, Vadva and Birju actually taught me what MICE events was. I worked with them for a year and a half, but given the fact that, you know, I already had a business family, and, you know, they always wanted me to do my business, and I met
you so much. Gujuche, business.
Ekdam gujuche. And at that point of time, I met Milind Soman. Okay, and I was, I think, all of 25 years old at that point of time. And I met Milind, and Milind said, I want to start a company with you. And I was like, oh my God, you know, I wouldn't leave anything in the world right now to have a company with you, Milind. You know, he was every girl's dream at that point of time. And I met him, and he says, I want to start a company with you. There was no thinking.
There you go.
There was no thinking, Shaju. I just went ahead with the plan, and what a good plan. So we had, and that's how Maximus came about. Both of us started it together. Maximus came about. But you know, the struggles of entrepreneurship are different. You know, at every point of time, it's a real struggle. There is, you know, you're as much as a job or entrepreneurship, you know, you have to have the risk-taking ability. Very important is you have the risk, you want to think differently. I think what we did is, if Maximus would have remained like a normal agency, we did MICE and luxury MICE, we really scaled in luxury MICE, but if we had just stuck to that, we would have been a run-of-the-mill agency.
Sure.
You know, like any other agency, which I think we have more than 10,000 agencies across India. I think what happened is, if we had not struck an IP, or if we had not created something that was unique, you will never stand out. And this is for everybody who wants to be an entrepreneur here. Please don't start an agency, because there is money involved in that. The day you're able to create value in your agency and you are able to stand apart from the others is when you should start your entrepreneur venture. Otherwise, it's not going to last. It will fail. And you have to be prepared for that. Because, you know, you might get a few clients in the beginning and you might make some big bucks in the beginning, but it's not the way to be. You have to create value in your organization only for, so don't think short term, think long term, create value, and the money will follow. Money will follow. Absolutely. And how? You won't even imagine what you've done. So be patient. You know, you're to stick to your goals, create a goal and stick to that goals and create something different. Because if you're not going to create something different, you're going to fail.
Fail, yeah. Keep that value constantly. In fact, I see Sushil is here. Sushil, thank you for making sure Rima got that grounding in events. Sushil saying, two sporting, eventful people together. That's so sweet, yeah, Sushil.
I just spoke about you, Sushil, and I always speak about you. And you know, thank you for teaching me all that I know today.
My big sister and your little sister Sushma is here as well. She's saying, well said, Rima. You know, the mate of teaching and events.
Mate, thank you for coming. Hi, Sushma.
Yeah. So really at that time, and this is something we say, right, that take an event management career is always a question mark about the risk taking, you know, sustenance, long term. So you kind of gave us an insight to how it happened. And then you said how to keep the value going. For students of today and in the current times, I'm just jumping straight to the current times. People are not sure that is this a career path, Rima? Whether it's event management, whether it's IP creation, or whether it's sports event management. What do you have to say about that from now till the future?
I think one thing you should know that yes, this industry. Are you talking pandemic time or just generally?
I'm talking pandemic, post pandemic and beyond, because currently in the last one, everybody's kind of on a pause, right? And a lot of prospective students or want to enter the event management or the sporting event business are on a question mark right now.
So I would first of all, I would like to say that if you want to be an entrepreneur, and I'm not talking jobs right now, but if you want to be an entrepreneur and if you can't think differently, you know, if in your business you don't expect any ups and downs to happen, then don't start a business. Yeah, as simple as that. Because if you're not going to be ready for the downs, then please don't start your own business. Please take up a job. In the job, I would just say one thing, that, you know, our industry suffered, but agencies have kept the people in the company who have performed and who have thought out of the box and who have contributed to creating that value for the company. So I also downsized my company because that was the need of the hour, but I didn't let the people who matter the most go. So if you turn into that person, it's all about you. So if you turn into the person who is most valuable to the company is never going to let you go. So both ways, right? So both ways, whether you're an entrepreneur, if you don't believe in yourself and you cannot adapt to change in your environment, then don't be an entrepreneur. As a job profile, if you're not valuable to the company will let you go. Whether it's a pandemic or no pandemic, because of a performance, they will let you go anyways. So my advice to you guys is make yourselves valuable both ways and keep creating value. You know, when I was in the call center, I was moved to the head of R&R is because I wanted to take initiative. There was more I could do than just do my mundane job every day. So initiative is the key for everything in this world. You do more than you're expected to do, you will be valuable. And you do it right as well, you will be valuable. Nobody's ever going to let you go, right? So I don't think, and this applies to every industry, whether it's the sporting industry, whether it's the event industry, whether it's the wedding industry. If you are valuable, you will stay.
It's, I think, also about what I keep trying to tell my colleagues or just friends in the business, right? Be proactive rather than reactive, because you have to be up about the game of the others. And whether you're an entrepreneur or whether you're working with a company or a team, right? It's about, like you rightly said, the value add. So
and
if it's a company.
Competition is fierce. So you have to be on the top of the game at all points of time. As an entrepreneur, though, you have to be on the top of the game. Otherwise, please don't be an entrepreneur who wants to just say, oh, there's a pandemic. Oh, what do I do? Oh, how do I live? How do I survive? No, figure out ways of making yourself more valuable.
And if I may say, great opportunity to upskill as well. I mean, learn something new, learn something related, pick up a course, whether it's, you know, related to the business or otherwise. Great time for that as well. What it's been?
I personally think learning is an ongoing process and it should never stop, whether a pandemic, no pandemic. But yes, because you have more time right now, maybe you can upskill, but it shouldn't be a one-time process. You should keep upskilling, because
ongoing.
As an entrepreneur, if you don't upskill and don't move to better conversations, don't move to more evolved conversations, and that only happens out of upskilling and learning all the time, I mean, you don't stand a chance. You can't keep talking about the same things and say, oh, I'm still the entrepreneur who made a difference. No, you have to keep learning, keep growing, keep upskilling, keep learning, keep reading. Reading is another thing that you should keep doing. Keep reading lots and lots, reading of whatever might interest you, but keep reading, because it opens up a whole new world. It really does. It makes you talk differently. Knowledge is power. So if you have knowledge about anything in this world and you can talk about those things while you're making a conversation with people, you stand apart.
Awesome. Reema, that brings me to, I mean, in this last 12 to 18 months, right? Everybody had to reinvent what we were doing.
Absolutely.
How did you keep the brand Pinkathon alive? And I'm bringing Pinkathon. I'm sure there are other work you do and other clientele you service. But I'm picking in Pinkathon. How did you keep that brand alive? Give us some thoughts on that.
So the first thing we started post the pandemic is we realized that we are a mass event, right? Again, a lot of disturbance started. Is there a fan at the back?
I'm sorry. No, there is no fan. Yeah.
Okay.
I'm so, sorry about that.
Now it's better. Okay, so given the fact that we are a mass event, we have to be really responsible. And given the fact that this COVID was spreading out of contact, all the more, right? So we had to kind of put a halt on the ground events because we can't be seen as an irresponsible event. But what we did do is digitally, fitness at home is the first thing we inculcated. So we started something called Pink at Home. And Pink at Home was every day put up, you know, we started a whole campaign and put up your stories, and we would amplify those stories of every individual that worked out at home. And that became, Pink at Home became a movement. The other thing that we launched is a digital event, which is called Republic Day to Independence Day. And every day of your life you run, and you record that on our apps, and and we are constantly monitoring you. And we have generated over 60 lakh rupees as of now towards donations, through Republic Day to Independence Day run. What we did was the largest run through the pandemic, which was the Pinkathon Day, which had 20,000 runners. It was the largest running event of the country. And we had 300 locations, not only in India, but across the world participating. So we had 12 countries and participating in the Pinkathon Day on 1st of October last year. And we had 20,000 runners running on that particular day, spreading the message of fitness, pink, all of it on one given day. So that was the Pinkathon Day. Pink at Home continues. Of course, Republic Day to Independence Day will end soon on the Independence Day. And we've done, we also introduced our newsletter, our first ever newsletter, which was another, which was a space in media that we started for the Pinkathon, which is a Pinkathon newsletter that is now, so this is the way we kept in touch with our clients. I think, through the news of Pinkathon, through what all we are doing, all of those things, and we kept in touch with our clients as well as all the runner community. Amazing. That's happening. More
amazing.
So,
and a lot of team members, right? A lot of team members would be part of this movement, right? I mean, you can't run it alone, right? So your office and team were active all across during these times.
Absolutely. And 500, so the Pinkathon core team out of Mumbai, as well as the entire ambassador community of 500 ambassadors across the world, all active. In fact, a recent event that we did was 251 Surya Namaskars and 251 Surya Namaskars on the day of the International Yoga Day. We celebrated Pinkathon with women doing 251 Surya Namaskars at a go. And this was a live event and for everybody to watch. It was unbelievable. But like I say, every day, while we are talking right now, Shaji, there is an event happening. Off Pinkathon, and I wouldn't know what is happening. What is happening? So it's amazing.
In fact, it's reached a stage. Even if you want to, that you can't do it, you will not be allowed to, because now the movement has taken off. The plane has taken off. Now you can't stop that.
Yeah, absolutely. And I would never want to stop it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Remember, I told you, I'm in love now.
Yeah. How are your team members at home? Sean and Shiv during this time, were they backing up wifey dear or mommy dear during these times?
Oh, yeah. I mean, things at home are, all of us are pandemic struck. So, but it's different. I think I have so much more time with Shiv. And it's amazing how another thing, by the way, since we're talking about sports, and anybody who has children here, I want to tell you guys that, children will ape what you're doing at home. So if the father is doing push-ups and pull-ups and sports and gym and running, the child will pick up the same things, and if the mother is doing the same thing and she's baking or she's doing cooking or she's running or she's whatever, my child does the same things. He wants to go cycling, he wants to go running, and if you wake him up at 6 o'clock in the morning, he has no issues. So he wants to do all the things his parents want to do and probably better them. So I think we are role models for our own kids, and that is one thing that all of us do. So great habits will make great kids.
Absolutely. And guess what? This moment also, this phase also gave us a time where the men entered the kitchen as well, experimenting, right? And the women also got an opportunity to kind of explore beyond what they were doing at home, if they are homemakers.
Yeah. Well, I have a big argument on that one, that why men enter the kitchen only during the pandemic. I mean, both of these, you know, everybody today is working, everybody today is doing their job. This is tough on everybody. I think it's a shared responsibility. We should all be on an equal platform. I keep saying this all the time, and I believe in it completely. And, you know, I don't think if a woman, like, you know, typically our culture says that man is the bread earner and woman is the homemaker. If woman at some point has become the bread earner, then why can't the man be the homemaker as well? And I think it's so important to not even now talk about these things, because I think it's absolutely frivolous. And whoever wants to enter the kitchen can enter, and whoever doesn't want to enter the kitchen can not enter. As simple as
I wanted that plug, right? I wanted that plug.
I'm so sure.
I got a comment. KCT saying, I feel mopping the floor has been a great exercise for men and abs. Why men only? Again, the same thing, right? Yeah, I mean.
This is culture, Sharju. This is how we talk, unfortunately. We don't change this in the language, and the day we change our language, that, you know, men are mopping now. So, like, where? You know, just, it's okay. Why make such a big deal? But let me tell you, one of my fitness mantras during the pandemic, the first part of the pandemic, was to sweep and mop the floor. And when we did not have the maids at home, we swept and we mopped and we did and we enjoyed. And we said, this is cardio, man. This is cardio.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah. And our children did it too. So our children had the same thing to do, and they were mopping and cleaning. And today, I feel Shiv has a habit of cleaning the table every time he's finished food.
I was about to tell you, it's actually become a habit in my household as well, where once taken on the washing machine, once taken on the mopping, yeah. You know, it's become now a habit, which is great.
Which is, I think, pandemic has taught, finally brought some culture change and said, okay, everybody's equal, you know, and
there's always a silver lining. There's always a silver lining.
100%.
I want to ask you something, Vima, is that, I mean, you work with a lot of professionals, your team members, when they come in to be part of either the servicing business,
yeah,
or the IT business, right?
Yeah.
How important is it for, let's say, a newcomer into the business to be equipped with education in sports management? And I'm picking this up as sports management or sports event management.
Yeah.
Is the importance of sport education now for the professionals who are going to join our business?
Education is the key, right? I think we were unlucky at that point of time to not have this hands-on knowledge. And today we have, I mean, you have access to absolutely, so you literally know everything before you're getting into, and you know what you're getting into. I think this, and I think, like I kept saying, learning, educating yourself, reading, enriching your knowledge. Knowledge is power. And if you already have the knowledge before you're getting into, venturing into anything, and is amazing. Like I said, ISM is, I think the front runner in doing sports education in the country. And that's amazing, because there was a big gap here. And, all kudos to ISM, you, Nilesh, all of you, to make this happen for India, I would say. And if kids have the access to this kind of education to literally specialize in sports, it's amazing. They know exactly
Absolutely.
What they're getting into.
Right, yeah. And kudos to actually Nilesh and Rasika and the team, you know, for they started 11 years back,
yes,
not knowing what the future was, right? And today where they are. In fact, they got the President's Award last year for one of the best sporting institute in the country. So I think it's slowly and steadily getting there.
Yeah. But right. Like I said, you know, you have to think of that idea, see what the country wants, what the system wants. And, you know, go with it. And I think Nilesh has done just that. It's amazing.
True.
And he's going to just go. Because
absolutely.
It's the need of the hour. Formal education is always amazing.
So great. So we are now 30 minutes into our chat, Reema.
So should we take some questions from everybody else? Because I can't see much. I need my specs.
I was actually, we are already 50 minutes. 5-0,
I'm
joking.
Okay. She says, Shaju, please take off your t-shirt and show Sushma on screen.
Take off the t-shirt? No, I've worn the t-shirt today after 2 years. Thanks to Sushma sending it
to me.
Thank
you so much. Thanks to me remembering that it has Sushma.
There's a question which I see from, I think, Farhan, if I've got, yeah. Can I become an agent after completing education from IISN?
Agent?
I mean, I can, yeah. I mean, I assume Farhan is talking about being a sports agent. So if I can take that question, Rima, that in the sports management education course or the curriculum, you know, apart from the foundation in sports management, there's also specialization, you know, whether you want to become an entrepreneur or you want to become a creative marketer or you want to become get into broadcast or you want to become a sports agent. So opportunities are 360 in the field of sports, right? So that's your answer.
Absolutely. I mean, you can become whatever you wish to.
K. Balla says, expressionable face. Okay, Raj has joined in. Can I work for you both? Raj Nayak?
Is he here?
The affordability?
Okay.
I don't know.
Raj? Raj, yes, Raj. Can we work
the,
for
the
you,
dawn, the dawn of media and entertainment is asking that, right? I mean...
Yes, Raj, can we work for you, Raj?
So my friend all the way from Goa, Rakshit, is on in. He's saying, what about starting a rural run for villagers? Pinkathon can add value to women in villages.
So, I don't know. We've not reached villages as yet, but we have something called India Going Pink. And in that, we've already done runs at Raipur. Vizag. So we've reached tier 2. As of now, and we will slowly penetrate more and more and more. But yes, the idea is to paint India pink with fitness, health, and wellness, and you know, and also to break stereotypes attached to women. So yes, we're absolutely going to do that. I want to tell you that when we did this run in Nasik, there were women who did 21 kilometers, all barefoot, and let me tell you how many women, all rural women, who had participated. And they were all barefoot, and 100 of them did 21k barefoot.
Awesome.
It was unbelievable, Shah.
That's the power. That's the power of it.
That's
I mean, really, this is empowerment at its highest peak. Yeah.
In fact,
we have another super friend here, and I think he should be leading this venture. Brian Tellis is here.
Brian.
And he's saying, I also want to volunteer to work for y'all. So you know what Brian is.
Should we just shut this conversation? Oh my God, we are going to get stopped.
I think we can create an idea here for the country, right? Of how to create something new now.
Oh, Brian is the ideas man anyways, right? So yeah, Brian, like we said, we want to work for you, Brian.
So guys who are tuned in here, including the students fraternity or even professionals who might be thinking, you know, Rima, this is something I was chatting with Nilesh and Rasika as well.
Yeah.
That there are a lot of professionals who are looking probably for a career switch in such times, not just because of the pandemic, but also in terms of a future. Follow your passion. A lot of us, you know, love sports, but we kind of choose a career path because of, you know, commercials, peer pressure, family pressure. Here's a moment where you want to follow. You could not probably follow professional sports, so maybe you can be a professional manager now, right, in various capacities.
Of course, you know, I have seen Shaju in the pandemic. I have people have followed their heart, and a lot of people who, you know, probably were really, so events is tiring, right? Events is very tiring because we're on the run. Even after 13 years, I felt that I've now taken a break, you know, that because for 13 years we've kept running. So I think every profession has a shelf life, and if and finally there will be a day where it will dawn upon you that let me do what I love, let me really do what I love, and you will. And pandemic, I think, has given an opportunity to take that break and to reassess and to reinvent yourself, and whether it was moving into events or moving out of events, both have happened. And you know, pandemic has resulted into all kind of shifts, but it has happened. And people have either followed events or not, but they followed their passion, and that's important. And finally, you have the opportunity to do this, because when we are running towards something, and we forget what we've actually loved. And that's the break that the pandemic gave you, to reassess your life.
Absolutely. Yeah. So let's reignite our passion back, or those who are already passionate about it. It's a natural flow. Natural flow. It's a natural flow away, yeah. But Reema, I'm going to catch the time because now we are almost 60 minutes there, so I don't want to lose our conversation completely. Any final words for all of wonderful people who joined in here?
I think once again, the pandemic has taught me a lot of stuff, but I always believed in something, and I end my conversation by saying that whatever I wanted to do in life, I wanted to inspire. I wanted many other people to do it. I wanted to create movements. I wanted to do things like that, and I did it. And that's because I always wished to. But and that's what I say, that everything that you do in life, try and touch upon other lives with the lives that with what you are doing. To live to inspire is something that I go by all the time. Otherwise, all the entrepreneurial jargon I can give you, but on the emotional front, I would say live to inspire, because that is what you're going to take back with yourself. That legacy that you leave behind is really what you're going to take back with you. And don't lose time on that one. Start, you guys are well young, said. Start young. We didn't have the, we jumped into things that were, maybe out of compulsion. Like I worked for a call center out of compulsion because I didn't want to do a certain thing. You guys today have the choice to follow your passion, do that, and do that by inspiring others around you.
Amen to that. Well said, Reema. Well said. And at this moment, thank you everyone who joined in. To our Dons, Raj Nayak and Brian Tellis, thank you for joining in. We are going to connect back to you. Shushma, Rakshit, Tanaz. I think a lot of more people joined in. We couldn't figure out. Rasika says, thank you, Reema, for the insights. It's been truly a pleasure. Truly a pleasure to have you.
Wonderful chatting with you. Always. And keep this going. Keep the Spot On series going. Keep inspiring. I think it's really doing well. And I hope more and more of you enter the world of sports, because that is going to be the future.
We will keep that on. Thank you so much. The energy and the love will keep us going season upon season, really. So every Saturday, 5 p.m., Spot On series will be back here with another new personality. Great light today. Great fun today, Reema. More power to you and to Milin and the team at Pinkathon. Cheers.
Cheers to Pinkathon. Let's live to inspire.
Really. Take care.
Take care, Shah.
Stay well. Have a sporty weekend, guys, as Brian Tellis says. Right? And I keep saying that. Stay sporty and stay happy, everyone.
Oh, I see Brian working out every morning. Yeah, so for sure.
Yeah. Right.
Take care, guys.
We all catch up together for a run together, Reema. Thank you so much. Thank you, my dear. I'll see you soon.
Bye.
So guys, that was Reema Sanghvi, founder of Pinkathon, along with a partner, Milin Soman. What a wonderful journey they've given us about, and truly empowerment for women, for families across the country, and now on a global phenomenon, a global movement. So kudos to them. We shall be back next Saturday once again with a new episode of Spot On series with another great personality coming through. Until then, like I say, stay sporty, stay happy, and I'll see you guys soon. Take care.